Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to Queen Margaret University. I'm Petra Vent. I'm the principal of Queen Margaret University. And before John Swinney speaks, I would just say a couple of words about Queen Margaret. I'll be very brief because you're not here to listen to me. Queen Margaret University was founded in 1875 as the Edinburgh School of Cookery. And when people hear that for the first time, they smile. But there's a very serious message behind that, because we were one of the first colleges to give women an education, and it was about improving the health of the working classes. So very important messages. This is still in our DNA nowadays, so our values at Queen Margaret University are all about social justice and having a positive impact on people. We also say in our vision statement that we are a community without borders. That means there's a lot of local engagement. However, that is also abroad. We have a lot of international engagement. We are a very international university. So we teach and research in India, in Nepal, in Singapore, in Greece, in Egypt. So we spread ourselves quite widely. Now we are a very, very vibrant university here in Musselburgh. And we always say we concentrate on three flagships. We do lots of things, but the three flagships we are concentrating on is health and rehabilitation, culture and creativity, and sustainable business. Now, we've always welcomed politicians here before. When you look, if you happen to mill around or before when you had coffee, you might have seen the timeline downstairs in the atrium of Queen Margaret University, and there are lots of photos of politicians as well. So we had the First Minister here a number of times, both the previous one and the current one. Mike Russell has been here in his various roles a number of times. Minister for Justice, Health, Mental Health, MSPs, MPs, and so on. We seem to be quite a magnet, but we are honored to add John Swinney here today, the Deputy First Minister, to this list. Everyone here is keen to support and shape the agenda of creating conditions for children and young people to shine and to give them real choices in life. I myself was a commissioner on the Commission for Widening Access, and I'm now chairing a work stream for the Scottish universities on how to simplify and at the same time scale up bridging programs for school children, college leavers, and so on to get into university. That agenda is very close to my heart, and it's very close to my heart because I personally would not have had the opportunity to go to university had it not been for the intervention of teachers at all levels in my school career. At Queen Margaret now, we try to realize the ambitions of giving opportunities to all those who have the potential to achieve. One such example is the Children's University. We are the first and the biggest one in Scotland. So we have over 3,500 children on board in over 36 schools. And it's really about raising ambitions and showing children and parents and carers that universities are not ivory towers. It's about demystifying universities. Today we are talking, or not we, John Swinney is, about equity and excellence. But to achieve equity and excellence, we also need good leadership at all levels. And that was crucial to the agenda of Teaching Scotland's Future, Graham Donaldson's review. And that was also key to the discussions of the National Implementation Board for Teaching Scotland's Future, which I chaired. So throughout that particular board, we talked about the staff development needs for teachers, but in particular head teachers in this context is absolutely vital. And it's also vital for the work of SCEL. And I can see that SCEL is here today as well. Now, unfortunately, I have a pressing engagement and cannot stay, but I know this session is being recorded, will be watched later. So I'm really keen to hear what the Deputy First Minister has to say on how we can all work together to ensure excellence and equity for children and young people in Scotland. Dr. Richard Butt, the Deputy Principal, he will stay, and he's also going to chair the question and answer session afterwards. So for now, welcome again. Thank you all for coming. And over to John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills.
Thank you very much, Petra, for those words of welcome. And it is indeed a great pleasure to be at Queen Margaret University this morning. Before I open up my remarks on my topic around education this morning, let me just reflect on the terrible events in Westminster yesterday, which have affected us all. Our thoughts this morning are with the victims, with their families, and with all of those affected. And yesterday's events are a vivid reminder to us of the courage of our public servants and also the sanctity and significance of our democratic process. And later today, we expect that Parliament in Edinburgh will have the opportunity to reflect on these issues and the events of yesterday. But I certainly want to mark the opening of my remarks with a tribute to those who exercised such courage and bravery yesterday, and for some who lost their lives in awful circumstances. So as I said, Petra, it's a great pleasure to be at Queen Margaret University this morning, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. The campus here is a truly open one, welcoming students from all over the world, as well as from the wider Scottish university. It is the second university in Scotland to host the Children's University, raising the aspirations and broadening the learning horizons of 7 to 14-year-old school children across the east of Scotland. That in itself is a transformational initiative that the Scottish Government is pleased to support as it takes steps to, in your words, Petra, to demystify the approach to higher education for young people within our society. And it's a welcome initiative amongst many others that are taken as part of the values of Queen Margaret University. I was appointed as Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills 10 months ago, and since then have been engaging closely with all aspects of our education system. When the First Minister asked me to assume this role, I recognised it would be challenging, but I also recognised it is the greatest privilege to have the opportunity to shape the future of Scottish education. The First Minister conveyed a clear message by asking me to take on this post. By appointing her Deputy First Minister as Education Secretary, she signalled the significance she attached to strengthen Scottish education. I want to take this opportunity to reflect on some of the impressions I have gained from Scottish education to date, and to explain the direction I intend to take in the period that lies ahead. Since my appointment, I've been clear about my purpose in this role. I see it to ensure that every child has an equal chance to fulfil his or her potential, to deliver the best possible outcomes for all children, and to use every moment in this Parliament to interrupt the cycle of deprivation and poverty which affects the life chances of far too many children and young people in Scotland. Put simply, my job is to deliver the brightest future for Scotland's youngest generation. In taking that task on, I inevitably reflect on my own experience. I went to Forrester High School in this city, a school packed with teachers of quality and of inspiration. It gave me strong educational foundation, and is a time that I look back on with great fondness. One reflection, however, has never left me. When I started first year, it was in a group of 120 pupils. By the time I reached sixth year, there were just 8 of us left. Many of my contemporaries had left school to go on to pretty poor destinations. They were young people who had not fulfilled their potential. For too many of my classmates, poverty and inequality determined their future. And two generations later, poverty and inequality continue to hit the life chances of too many of our young people today. There can never be a time when we are not striving to do much better for our young people. Education is by far the most effective means we have to improve their life chances, and I'm determined to seize the opportunity the First Minister has given me to use it to transform lives for the better, and in doing so, transform the future of our country. That is my agenda for Scottish education. The question, of course, is how to achieve this aim. Since my appointment as Education Secretary, one thing is abundantly clear to me. There is no shortage of opinions on what I should do. We have a vibrant, healthy contest of ideas about policy and performance. That is as it should be. But sadly, some of the contributions to that debate create an impression of Scottish education that is simply false. A wholly unrepresentative picture is sometimes given of our schools, colleges, and universities. It serves neither the country nor our children and young people for that impression to go unchallenged, and I challenge it at every opportunity. But nor does it serve anyone for the challenges we do genuinely face to go unacknowledged and unaddressed. In assessing what is fair constructive criticism and what is simply political rhetoric, there is only one yardstick, the data. And let's start with the positives. We now have more young people achieving excellent exam results. The number of advanced higher passes last year reached an all-time high, while the number of higher passes surpassed 150,000 for only the second time. 4 out of 10 students from Scotland's 20% most deprived areas left school in 2014-15 with at least one higher or equivalent, double the rate in 2007. We have more school leavers going on to positive destinations. A record 93.3% went on to positive destinations in 2015-16, up from 87% in 2007. Over 90% of full-time and over 93% of part-time college students are satisfied with their overall college experience. We have a record university entry rate of 10.9% for 18-year-olds from the 20% most deprived areas in Scotland, a 3.7 percentage point increase since 2006. And in 2014-15, 91% of graduates from Scottish higher education institutions went into either employment, further study, or a combination of the two. That is what some of the data tells us. It shows that those who seek to run down Scottish education are choosing to ignore the objective reality of our system in pursuit of an ideological aim or to inflict political damage on the government for other purposes. But it's not the only thing the data tells us. Whilst we must promote the positives, if we are to close the attainment gap and raise the bar for all, we must also acknowledge and address the challenges. Our PISA scores, the OECD's international measure of school education performance, have fallen, and they reflect the same finding as our own figures on literacy and numeracy from the SSLN. Based on the data we have gathered on achievement of curriculum for excellence levels, we can see that the proportion of children achieving the CFE level relevant for their age falls throughout the primary stages. So for reading in P1, 81% of children achieve, but by P7, this drops to 72%. We need to raise that bar. It is true that by S3, 86% of young people are achieving third level in reading and 86% are achieving the third level in numeracy. But looking at the attainment gap, we see that 79% of young people from the lowest SIMD quintile achieve third level in reading, whilst 93% from the highest quintile achieve the same level. We need to close that gap. In higher education, yes, more pupils from poorer backgrounds are going to university, but it is equally true that they remain massively underrepresented. We need to widen access. Our debate, therefore, must start from a truly informed perspective and focus on what now needs to be done to build upon that strength of performance. So I come back to the many voices telling the government what we should do on education. I've been critical today of those who would run down Scottish education, but that's not the only voice raised in the debate. It is striking to me that despite the range of data detailing the challenges that we face, one of the more common comments I hear is from those that say that nothing needs to change. This comes home most forcefully in the consultation on school governance. We're still digesting the 1,100 or so responses, but already it is clear that there's a strong body of opinion that does not accept the need for change. And what is perhaps most worrying is that that body of opinion is from within Scottish education. I want to be clear today that my opinion, the view of the Scottish Government, is clear. Looking at the data, the status quo is not an option. Change is needed, change is happening, and more change is coming. The barrier poverty and inequality poses is significant. The challenges of raising the bar and closing the gap are real. To take them on, we need to reform our approach to get the whole system pulling in the same direction. In policy terms, we need an integrated framework that meets the needs of all young people at every stage of their journey through life. That policy framework is provided by the three building blocks of getting it right for every child, curriculum for excellence, and developing Scotland's young workforce. Perfect because it captures the need to work right across the system, across every agency in support of young people and their families, from pre-birth right through the earliest stages of life into adulthood. Curriculum for Excellence, which has reshaped how we deliver education from 3 to 18, to provide a flexible and child-focused curriculum, and developing Scotland's young workforce to improve skills for work by extending flexible vocational pathways for young people. We must ensure that all three of these are woven together to deliver excellence and equity for all of our children and young people. Most importantly, we must move forward with implementing these frameworks and at all times continuing to improve outcomes for children and young people. Achieving excellence and equity for our children is a systemic challenge, one that our whole system needs to respond to. Every child and family is different, so our work with them needs to respond to those individual circumstances. It needs to start before birth and reach into adulthood, and it needs to be holistic at every step, disregarding any structural boundaries that might get in the way. Put simply, our public services need to focus on the individual, not on their own organisational arrangements. Later today, a major plank of that approach will be set out in a statement to Parliament by my colleague, the Childcare and Early Years Minister, Mark MacDonald. Mark will lay out the way forward as we expand the provision of free, high-quality early learning and childcare from 600 hours now to 1,140 hours by the end of this Parliament. While parliamentary rules mean I cannot preempt his statement, I can tell you that flexibility, choice, and the needs of individual children and families will be at the heart of what the Minister announces this afternoon. In my former role as Finance Secretary, I brought forward much of the government's agenda on public sector reform. The foundation of that approach was the report of the Christie Commission, a thoughtful and accessible agenda that encouraged us to focus on early intervention to avoid storing up long-term problems. In my new role, the value of that agenda was reinforced to me when I recently attended a speech and language therapist roundtable event where I had the opportunity to hear from a gentleman called Thomas McCruden. Thomas told us a story of his life and outlined how he had presented in his very early years with communication difficulties. That unresolved problem led to difficult family circumstances. He became a very troubled individual in his teenage years, and the result, that he was detained in custody. It was a situation crying out for a coordinated early intervention approach. It was a situation crying out for a GIRFEC approach. But what was clear to me from Thomas's experience is that our public services had not intervened when they needed to, despite the many signals that he needed help. That needs to change. Our education system must ensure that the diverse needs of children and young people are met, and met in full. That is one of the central aims of Curriculum for Excellence. Embedded in it are the values of wisdom, justice, compassion, and integrity. In a stroke of imagination and genius, those who designed Curriculum for Excellence took the words that are inscribed on the mace of the Scottish Parliament, the words that have helped to define our democracy in Scotland, and linked them to the curricular approach in every one of our 2,500 schools in Scotland. It is one of our primary purposes to instill those values in our young people and help them to think through their own viewpoints on matters of social justice and personal responsibility. These values underpin the reason that CFE developed in a way that goes beyond academic attainment and considers all of the four capacities our young people will need to make a success of their lives: successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens, and effective contributors. CFE recognises that every child is unique and creates a level of flexibility in the curriculum to enable every child to achieve their potential. This flexibility is crucial to the achievement of excellence and equity. Personalisation means that children and young people get the right support, but also that they get the stretch and the challenge that they need. So CFE allows a level of flexibility which enables us to get it right for every child, ensuring that all children can achieve these four capacities. This approach is what has set Scotland apart as a global innovator in education, and we should be proud of it. The OECD Review of Curriculum for Excellence provided a springboard for the next phase of development. They reaffirmed that CFE is the right approach for our children and lauded Scotland for the bold approach that has been taken. But the OECD review also set out some challenges, particularly to be more specific about the changes and the outcomes that we want to see. Our International Council of Education Advisors are in agreement that CFE is the right approach for us to take, and they have begun to challenge us to think about where we can improve further. The National Improvement Framework set out a clear vision for Scottish education: excellence through raising attainment, ensuring that every child achieves the highest standards in literacy and numeracy set out within curriculum for excellence levels, and the right range of skills, qualifications and achievements to allow them to succeed. And it also set out the vision of achieving equity, ensuring that every child has the same opportunity to succeed, with a particular focus on closing the poverty-related attainment gap. The clarity of the National Improvement Framework has been well received across Scotland and is now beginning to have a visible effect on our education system. The National Improvement Framework will ensure that we have the evidence to show us what is working and what is not working in our schools and beyond. The National Improvement Framework is not an academic exercise or a collection of data for the sake of having it. The key thing here is how we use this evidence and further evidence about what is effective practice, both in Scotland and further afield, to help drive improvement for all of our young people. If we are to achieve the defining mission, we must constantly be examining our progress and checking whether we are on track. If we are not making the progress that we need, then we must act, and act promptly. To understand where positive change has been made for children and young people and where further improvement is required, we need the best possible data. We have begun to increase the transparency of performance information about Scotland's schools by publishing the percentage of children achieving curriculum for excellence levels in literacy and numeracy on a local authority by local authority and school by school basis. Initial data in December showed that most children are achieving the expected CFE level for their stage. In future years, these statistics will be informed by national standardised assessments. This information gives the most detailed picture ever of progress in the broad general education across Scotland as we move to achieve excellence and equity. We know that schools and local authorities are already focused on that information, and that is informing their future planning. It will also provide a platform for us to work more closely with local authorities and other partners to continually develop our understanding of where children's progress can be improved and where lessons of good practice can be learned. We must use our knowledge of current practice that works and attempt to discern where that practice is accelerating closure of the attainment gap. We also need to bring evidence of proven interventions to bear where concerns are identified. In the vast majority of cases, there is a strong evidence base for early and effective working with parents and families and for direct intervention with children and young people. We have great examples across Scotland on interventions to improve early vocabulary and literacy, for nurture within school, for support in secondary schools, and beyond that will help young people achieve their potential. These are already in place in pockets across Scotland. We need to ensure that these pockets of excellence are taken to scale across Scotland. Education Scotland has developed the National Improvement Hub to support this exchange of practice, and it is already widely used amongst practitioners. We will also be working with the Education Endowment Foundation across the early years and school years to make their international evidence base more accessible to the profession. And our research strategy will provide a deeper knowledge base to support practitioners. I want to be clear that all of this data and evidence is being developed for one reason and one reason alone: to improve outcomes for children and young people. The flexibility that is offered by CFE is crucial to meeting the needs of all children. However, we must also provide clarity in our schools. In order to maximise the impact of our early years policies and provide seamless support for children, we need to ensure that they have experiences in school that will excite, motivate and challenge them. Since taking on this role, I've listened carefully to what teachers and young people have been telling me. I've drawn on the advice of the teachers' panel and also the International Council of Education Advisors. The feedback that I've received across the board suggests that a radical decluttering of the system is necessary, alongside clarification of exactly what is expected from schools, teachers, and young people. Teachers must be free to teach. It is clear that too many documents and too much guidance had accumulated as CFE was implemented. We need clear, simple statements that give teachers confidence about what CFE does and does not expect of them. Within that, we need to be clearer and more specific about how children's progress is assessed, signalling where further support is needed. Based on that advice, I have moved to provide greater clarity about curriculum for excellence through the advice published by the Chief Inspector of Education in August 2016 and the literacy and numeracy benchmarks that were published in December 2016. I'm also reducing bureaucracy and workload by reducing the burden of assessment both on teachers and on young people through changes to the national qualifications. All of these endeavours have been welcomed by the teaching profession. Today I can confirm that I am continuing with the efforts to tighten and sharpen our education system, with the publication of benchmarks for all curriculum areas by Education Scotland on its National Improvement Hub. The literacy and numeracy benchmarks have already been well received, and it is important that we now have the full set for all areas of the curriculum. Benchmarks provide clarity for teachers on the standards our children and young people are expected to achieve within each curriculum level at curriculum area at each curriculum level. Their purpose is to make clear what children need to know to progress through the CFE levels. They will also support consistency in teachers' professional judgments. And importantly, I know and have heard from teachers and their leaders that benchmarks will help them to make sure that young people achieve the pace of progress they need and deserve right across the broad general education. If we are able to get the pace of progress and achievement right for every child, we will truly achieve excellence and equity. Teachers, young people and parents will also have much better information on which to decide the most appropriate levels of national qualifications to follow in the senior phase. This will ensure that young people are engaged in the right courses and the right presentations at the right levels. As well as providing exemplification on the Improvement Hub today, Education Scotland is planning to support local authorities and teachers as they start to use the new benchmarks. I've also been working with partners to consider further advice on the changes to our qualification system. This work is ongoing, and I will be saying more about this very shortly. We know that our workforce is central to achieving our ambitions for our young people, and we must invest in our many professionals to ensure we deliver for Scotland's children and young people. This begins before birth, and the bold ambition of the Maternity and Neonatal Review will deliver continuity of care for families during pregnancy, connecting directly with the Health Minister Universal Pathway, which provides a consistent route to support for that crucial early brain development up to age five. We are investing in 500 extra health visitors to ensure that every family is helped to get off to the best start. We know that effective leadership is key to the success of schools and the children who learn in them. We also know that sustained investment in professional development is central to ensuring that we are able to deliver quality learning and teaching, and we must create the space within the changes to our curriculum and the way in the reduction in bureaucracy to ensure that the teaching profession has adequate opportunity to undertake effective and consistent professional development. In June last year, I committed to working with the Scottish College for Educational Leadership to bring forward a new package of professional learning for established head teachers. I'm delighted to announce today that Excellence in Headship is now open for recruitment, and it will be backed by £400,000 of funding from the Scottish Government. This package of support will be managed by the Scottish College for Educational Leadership and will include opportunities for teachers to strengthen their leadership skills by selecting from a wide range of programme options, including the chance to focus on core themes of critical self-awareness, leadership of learning, leading system change, organisational effectiveness, and working beyond the school with community champions. The programme will also include exciting opportunities to learn from the experience of colleagues in other countries through an international exchange programme. I'm also delighted that the Hunter Foundation recognises the importance of school leadership and has joined with us in supporting this initiative. It's through their investment of £1 million over the next 4 years, alongside a further £2 million from the Scottish Government, that this can be delivered. In the first year, 320 head teachers will benefit from this fund and will be given the opportunity to join a transformational leadership programme delivered by Columba 1400. The role of the head teacher is challenging, but hugely rewarding, and I want to support teachers to take the step to headship while also committing to supporting head teachers already in post. Our faith in our head teachers and in our teaching professionals underpins the reforms we are now set upon. We are committed to empowering schools, teachers, parents and communities. The reforms that we have undertaken, with the introduction of £120 million in pupil equity funding, directly distributed to 95% of schools across Scotland, in a focused way to tackle the attainment gap, is an illustration of the direction of our agenda. This reform is creating an empowered profession, able to take decisions that matter to the lives of individual young people in the environment in which they live and are educated. This approach provides the opportunity to take forward proven educational interventions to close the attainment gap. It creates the freedom to establish partnerships with third sector organisations in youth work, youth advocacy and community learning and development to address the wider needs of young people as part of our efforts to ensure every young person is able to fulfil their potential. But empowering the profession is not an end in itself. Applying the principle of getting it right for every child leads you to ask, who is best placed to understand and meet the educational needs of individual children? Who knows them? Who is at the heart of their schooling? The answer is, I think, self-evident: teachers and parents. That is why my party's manifesto included a pledge to make teachers and parents the key decision makers in the life of a school. And it's why our reform of governments takes as a starting point the empowerment of schools. Decisions about a child's learning should be made as close to that child as possible. And decisions about a child's needs and how to meet them should be made by those around the child. This is a vision of empowerment and devolution from local authorities to schools to include head teachers, parents and communities, and devolution from a national to a local or a regional level. In taking this commitment forward, I know that school governance is one of the most debated areas in education, not just here in Scotland, but internationally. And I'm conscious that any attempt to import what works elsewhere will almost certainly fail. Our reform must be rooted in the strengths of Scottish education. There is no off-the-shelf answer. It must be made here in Scotland. The OECD work on governance, however, has much that will inform our reforms. It notes that as education systems face up to the complex problems of poverty and deprivation, successful systems are more likely to be those that are flexible, open and dynamic. And they identify the key strengths of being focused on processes, not structures, being flexible and able to adapt to change, building capacity, encouraging open dialogue and stakeholder involvement, taking a whole system approach and harnessing evidence and research to inform policy. We will bring forward our plans in due course and to Parliament in the first instance, so I will not go into great detail today, but I will give these pledges. Our reforms will be built on the best evidence of what will work. They will empower schools. They will not take the overly prescriptive, top-down approach so damaging elsewhere in these islands. And they will rightly put children and young people right at the heart of Scottish education. These will be major changes, and I know that change is difficult. It would be easy to accept the status quo, but doing more of the same will not achieve our ambitions for our children and young people and their future. Therefore, we will change our approach to the delivery of education. I intend to publish our next steps document in June, setting out how we will build on the proposals in the Education Governance Review and consult on our commitment to an appropriate funding formula to support these reforms. Beyond the school gate, we have shown the benefits of reform. We are blessed with colleges and universities that are world class. They are jewels in the crown of Scottish education. Our colleges have never been so focused on the needs of the young people that they serve. Yes, there are always challenges. National bargaining is still being negotiated, for example. But any objective assessment, our FE sector is in strong and good shape. That is a result of the hard work of the staff and the major reform of the sector undertaken in the last Parliament. It was a reform designed to deliver colleges dedicated to improving the life chances and employment prospects of young people. And anyone looking at the performance of the sector now will recognise the success that those reforms have delivered. In our world-class university sector, we will widen access so that more students from disadvantaged backgrounds have the opportunity to go to university. The appointment of Professor Peter Scott as our Commissioner for Fair Access will provide a clear focus for that work. And across both the HE and FE sectors, we are determined to improve the way we support our students through a review of funding that is now underway. Perhaps most crucially, however, will be our work on the learner journey. This seeks to join up the different parts of the system, building better pathways for pupils and students from school to work-based learning, college and university. In this, as in our reforms to schools themselves, we are taking a whole system approach that aims to place the individual at the heart of the reform. And to ensure success for our young people goes beyond formal study, we will continue to bridge the gap between education and industry to make sure more young people are work ready and promote the value of work-relevant learning. Sir Ian Wood's 2014 report is one of the most important and robust contributions to the government's thinking on education. It is a clear and compelling plan of action for giving young people the skills, experiences, and qualifications they need to move to positive destinations after school and to make informed choices about the jobs and the careers that they want to pursue. Developing the young workforce is about changing how we work together across the education and training systems to create the best opportunities for our young people, transforming how employers and educators work together to create the workforce of the future, expanding the options for work-based learning and changing how we value that vocational offer. Whilst there is still more to do, I'm encouraged by the significant progress that we're seeing firsthand in schools, colleges, and with employers across the country pulling together to give young people high-quality, work-relevant learning opportunities. In setting out our plans, I will hold true to our vision for Scottish education, excellence and equity, and our commitment to collaboration and cooperation rather than competition, to a system that gives every child a chance to succeed, to a system which supports rather than divides, and which places our children and young people at its heart. All of us need to ensure that we embody not just the letter of these policy building blocks, but the spirit of them, working together to achieve the best possible outcomes for children and young people. We need our whole system of public services across health, early learning, schools, colleges and universities, and with third sector partners to work together to achieve our ambitions. The First Minister has been clear that the defining mission of this government is to deliver excellence and equity in education. Excellence will raise the bar for all, and equity, we will close the attainment gap. That must happen in every setting, with everyone who can help, with each of you doing your best to get it right for every child and young person. Let's be bold in all that we do and relentless in our pursuit of excellence and equity for Scotland's children and young people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister, and good morning, everyone. We've got about half an hour for questions and answers. If I can, we'll take the questions in groups of three. If I can ask you to be succinct, to introduce, to tell us who you are, and to wait until the roving mics get to you before you speak. So, can we have our first questions, please? If you just stick your hand in the air, and I'll do my best Dave or Dimbleby impersonation. Gentlemen. Yeah.
Thanks so much. Larry Flanagan, EIS. John, there's a lot in your presentation, and I think in terms of the big ambitions, there'll be a lot of agreement around what we want to achieve. I'm interested in particular in relation to the idea of decision making at a school level. And you announced there the funding around the head teacher programme, which is a welcome investment, clearly. But Petra, in her introduction, talked about leadership at all levels, and that's the kind of area I'd like to ask you about, because we often hear people talk about leadership at all levels, but very quickly, everything then focuses on the head teacher. And we've got a very strong view that we should actually be talking about leadership at all levels and professional voice, and democratic schools. because we think it's not about heroic leadership, it's about collegiate approaches. And given the thrust of government policy around, you know, funding going directly to schools and schools having more decision-making powers, I'm interested in your thoughts on the idea of the democratic school, where we have the realisation of collegiality and distributive leadership, and we actually enable all teachers to be part of that decision-making process. Because I think if we realise that ambition, then our schools would be in a stronger place. So it's that idea of all professional voices being part of the debate.
Thanks. And then lady in the fourth row.
Susan Quinn, the EIS. I was interested there, John, and it really is just a seeking of clarification of current position on this, where you said that the CFE levels will be informed by the national standard assessments. Teachers will be keen to hear you repeat the message that actually what you're saying is that the professional judgment of teachers in relation to the achievement of a level will be informed in part by standardised assessments, and note that the CFE levels themselves that go into the NIF will simply be informed by those. Can you confirm that you haven't changed your position, that it will be teachers' professional judgment which will be used to collect the data that will be on the NIF in relation to the levels?
If I take one more question. Lady in the sixth row.
Hi everyone, I'm Jean Carwood Edwards, Chief Executive Early Years Scotland. I would really just like to say that we very much welcome as an organisation the expansion and the unprecedented levels of change that are currently taking place in early learning and childcare. However, given that we know how much the powerful and impactful patterns are set before children start school, would it not have been more appropriate and an opportunity if we had included children in their earliest years as part and parcel of the pupil equity funding?
Thank you.
Okay, let me work my way through those three questions. First of all, on Larry Flanagan's question, ultimately there is accountability in the system, and head teachers carry significant accountability for the performance of their schools. So the importance of having good, strong, clear and effective leadership in every school is, in my view, a compelling requirement of our system. But I think what I've seen around the country is examples where schools operating, yes, with that clear leadership from a head teacher, but with distributive leadership throughout the school, it's a very powerful an empowering environment within that school. So I suppose my answer to the question is a bit of both, that we need to have very clear and decisive leadership from head teachers to set the direction of schools, but there needs to be a climate within schools of an empowered profession that can make judgments and take initiatives and take forward approaches that meet the needs of young people. And that's essentially the heart of what I'm saying, that, you know, that everyone involved in the system needs to be looking at the interests of the child or young person and forming the right judgments to ensure their best opportunities are realised. Now, when I look at some of the examples that I see of how head teachers engage, I see a lot of good practice around the country. And if you take the examples of the pupil equity funding work that's been going on recently, I've seen numerous examples of head teachers going to very significant lengths to create a process that involves their local authority, their schools, their parental community, their pupils, wider third sector organisations, to make sure that they take the right time and care to consider what's the best way to utilise these resources and to take that plan forward in a collegiate sense, but with very clear direction underpinning the approaches that are taken. So I think there is every opportunity for that to be the case. But I think we do have to recognise that as a system, we need to continually invest, not just in head teacher leadership, but also in professional development for all staff within the system. And part of the purpose of the decluttering agenda that I've been taking forward has been to create the opportunity to and the space for members of the teaching profession to be involved in more sustained, continuous professional development. Because life is busy in schools, I can see that. And when I talk about reducing workload, it's reducing workload to create space for other things to be done, like professional development. So I think we, as we embark on this agenda, I think it is important that we have the right approaches to leadership within our schools, and to me that is a combination of head teachers being able to demonstrate that clear sense of direction that is required, but being able to create an environment of distributive leadership which empowers everyone within their schools. On the question about national standardised assessments, you're right, Susan, the government's position hasn't changed. The standardised assessments are an important part of informing teachers' judgment, and ultimately it will depend on teachers' judgment, the levels data that is produced. But what national standardised assessments will give us is a much more consistent base upon which teachers can make that judgment, linked, of course, to the benchmarks, which will now give much greater clarity to the system as young people take every step through their education system. And finally, on the issue of early years, the decisions we took on pupil equity funding were fundamentally addressing the issues that we confront within our school education system. And it was designed specifically for that purpose, to address the challenges that we face directly within our schools. Now, obviously, we are going through a process which over the course of the next few years will nearly double the capacity of the early learning and childcare system. And Mark McDonald will go through in more detail some of the key judgments we have come to based on the consultation exercise that we have undertaken. So forgive me if I don't get myself in trouble with the parliamentary authorities by saying too much about it just now. But the importance of ensuring the experience of children in early learning settings is one of quality will be absolutely central to what we set out in the course of the statement this afternoon. So although pupil equity funding has been focused at a school level, the other steps that we're taking through the expansion of early learning and childcare will, I think, address the issues that you've raised with me this morning.
Thank you. Next questions? Gentlemen, fourth row, and take sort of four rows up just there.
Thanks very much. Jim Swinney, the Chief Executive of Youth Link Scotland, the National Youth Work Agency. John, it was very heartening to hear you mention youth work, CLD more generally, and indeed the third sector and what they have to offer. I've been doing the rounds, going round talking to a whole lot of different councils and talking to our members as well. And I'm heartened in some places and absolutely devastated in others, because it's a very mixed picture about, A, the capacity that is left within the system because of a lot of cuts, but also on the good side, what we have to offer in terms of working with those young people who are most at risk and most in need. I think in youth work terms, you have a jewel in your crown, and I sincerely hope that most head teachers look both at their own local youth services within the local authority and within the third sector in their area and make good use and include them in to the programmes that they're thinking about, and indeed get them involved as early as possible in trying to shape those programmes. Because we have very good evidence from HMI and others and our own data that the actual outcomes for young people make a big, big difference and move it towards equity. I was also very heartened to hear you mention Christie and Wood, because I think sometimes when you don't hear them for a wee while, folk think they're dead. But I think they are absolutely critical to getting this right.
Okay, then, gentleman up there, and then lady.
Yes, thank you very much. Good morning, John. John Fife, Perth and Kinross. I certainly welcome the direction of travel that you've set out this morning and that which has been on the go for many, many months. And I also appreciate that if we are going to make change, something does have to happen. And I think an increase in head teacher autonomy is the right way forward in that. But one thing I'd like to say at the start is that local government bring coherence to a very complex policy landscape, and certainly works very hard to bring equity for all people of all ages, not just young people, but for elderly people and folk that are in work and out of work as well. And what I'd like to ask the question is, what you see is that relationship between a newly defined head teacher autonomy and the collective autonomy that is absolutely required to deliver change in our services across Scotland, and what you see is that relationship.
Hi, Cathy McCullough, Children's Parliament. Hi. You said in your speech, John, that decisions should be made by teachers, parents, and those around children. And you were asked about your view of democratic schools in relation to teachers and head teachers. I wonder what you think about the level of commitment in Scottish education to opportunities for children and young people's views to be the central guiding factor in improving outcomes.
Okay, let me just address those. First of all, on Jim's point, I think what I've tried to set out today is an approach which, and it relates fundamentally to Cathy's point as well, which puts the child or young person utterly central to the experience that they have within our system. And to make sure that decision-making addresses the needs of every single one of those young people and their differences and their different needs. I think one of the challenges, and I suppose some of this is reflected in the question that John Fife has asked me as well, is that there is a tendency in our public services to deliver an approach which is designed to be well formulated and well directed, but which might not address in every circumstance the distinct and diverse needs of every young person. And what I'm making the case for today is the need for us to recognise that there has to be more flexibility in how we take that forward. And there are, of course, many good examples, and you've cited them, Jim, within our schools, where schools are finding ways of ensuring they can sustain the engagement of young people to a greater extent with greater flexibility within individual schools. So young people may not be following exactly the same courses that are available for every other child in the school. There may be a bit of flexibility in how that is undertaken, flexibility in destinations and approaches that are adopted. And that's what I make the case for. And within that, I see a clear and distinctive role for youth work in helping that process, because fundamentally, we have to satisfy ourselves with every young person: have we done everything we could to ensure they could fulfil their potential? And for some young people, a conventional curricular approach will ensure that we can absolutely satisfy that question and answer it honestly and wholeheartedly. For others, it might not work like that, and we might have to take different approaches. But crucially, we've got to recognise those different approaches and reflect them in how we recognise the achievements that have been made. I think also there is an opportunity through the approach of pupil equity funding to ensure, not just pupil equity funding and empowered schools to address those different and diverse needs more effectively and more broadly than would be the case to date. Now, on John Fife's question, the pattern around the country will vary about the degree to which head teachers have as much autonomy as they need and do not have sufficient autonomy to act. And a lot of that is dictated by the approaches that are taken by individual local authorities, which will vary very significantly around the country in that respect. I continue to see local authorities, I made this clear at the time of the embarking of on the governance review, my view hasn't changed in this respect. I see local authorities as being the organisations of democratic accountability at local level for education. And yes, there is a need to put a order and cohesion into the system. I acknowledge that. But what I want to be involved in the course of the governance review is an approach which maximises the degree of flexibility that can be exercised at school level, because on the basis of that, we will find the answers to the needs of individual young people more effectively than we can if there isn't that degree of flexibility at local level. So there is, you're right to highlight a tension between greater headteacher flexibility and authority and autonomy and the collective autonomy of local authorities. Yes, there will be a tension in there. But what I want us to do is to answer the question based on what can deliver the best outcomes for young people, rather than what are the organisational structures that we have for some considerable time operated within Scotland. And then finally, on Cathy's point, I view the role and the participation of young people in the formulation of education policy to be absolutely central to how we take forward our agenda. So the steps that need to be taken at individual level, and some of this relates to the point that Larry Flanagan raised at the beginning as well, pupils need to be part of the conversation about the approaches that are taken within their own schools and within their own school community to ensure that their needs are satisfied as a consequence of that process. And the whole school community needs to be involved in that, but pupils need to be centrally involved in that process. And likewise, we have to recognise at a national level the importance of ensuring that the voice of young people, children and young people, is very clearly articulated in the process of our policy making. I was asked a question at the Education and Skills Committee just a couple of weeks ago as to what were the reasons why there wasn't a young person involved in the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board. And it's a pretty fair question, which I had to say, well, we'll sort that, which I will. So we have to make sure that at all levels, the voice of children and young people is heard very directly in formulating the policy in the direction that we take forward to ensure that young people's needs are most effectively met.
Lady just towards the back on your left.
Thank you, Jackie Brock, Children in Scotland. John, thank you very much for, I think, really heartening reinforcement of the importance of getting it right for every child and integration, and your mention of the universal health visitor pathway was really excellent. So thank you for that. I suppose could you just comment on, given how much you've been reinforcing the importance of integration, really heartening to hear that you hold Thomas's story in your mind, which was, for all of us who heard it, a great example of what we must do to improve our education. It's just kind of disappointing that in terms of then the structures that you're looking towards to address the issues of improving outcomes are very much around the school and local authority, when in fact the landscape, of course, that impact on integration is so much more complex, integrated joint boards being one example. Isn't actually the opportunity to be far more radical than maybe we've heard even so far in this room, to look at children's services and the right structures and flexibilities to enable integration from, well, in many ways pre-birth, but certainly day one of a child's life, and the way in which we could move forward in Scotland to look far more radically at those structures that could make a far more integrated impact, because I do worry that we're just looking at one particular slice of a child's life that is in many ways marginal to their wider outcomes.
Gentleman with the mic, yeah.
Good morning, John. Jim Thulis, School Leader Scotland. I thank you for your speech, which was wide-ranging and comprehensive and touched on most of the issues which are close to our heart. Could I perhaps take you into a specific area which was not obviously apparent within what you said? And it's the challenges which present to us in relation to delivering your agenda through shortages in teachers, both within specific subject areas and within certain geographical areas of the country.
Thank you. And then there's a lady just two rows behind.
Pauline Walker, the head teacher of the Royal High School in Edinburgh. I welcome your changes, and I thought your speech gave real hope for education in Scotland. And I think it's a really exciting and innovative time to be involved in education. It is a time for us all to test the change and test the waters. And my question is, will you give us time to allow a transformational change, or will you be looking for the quick wins to be the headlines? And my plea is, please go for the transformational change.
Okay. On Jackie Brock's question, I think the structural change is always challenging. He says euphemistically, and we have to embark on that with great care. Because with structural change, you always run the risk that existing practice and attention can be diverted while that is happening. Which is why I lay such emphasis in what I am setting out and on the importance of putting the child at the centre of all that we are doing and saying that to everyone involved in the public sector, regardless of the badge they happen to be wearing. To enable, to enable, to authorise, to motivate an ability and a capacity for people to think beyond just the boundaries of their organisation. And, you know, one of the arguments for structural change was made to me by a nursing auxiliary in Inverness, just shortly after the NHS Highland and Highland Council had integrated their children's services and their elderly services. And this nursing auxiliary was working in elderly services. And I said to her, what's the benefit to you of this structural change? And she said to me, the best thing about it is that I don't have any worries that I'll get bollocked for spending health service money on a local authority problem. Why? Because she was focusing on the needs of the elderly person she was caring for, and it was about what does this person need, what I need to fix, what I need to sort, rather than thinking, well, I can't do that bit, because that's really what the health service should be doing, and I'm a local authority person, or vice versa. So that's the argument for it, because it just liberates public servants from all of that. But that can be a time-consuming and sometimes distracting process. So what we have to encourage and motivate is that focus on the child and making sure that the needs of that child and of every young person is addressed. Now, I don't take the view that putting the school at the centre of all of this is anything marginal about it, because I think the school, in the reach that it can have, and with the ability to extend the influence of the good things that are happening in a school setting, can have a really significant effect on the well-being of young people. The other week there, I was in Dalmarnock Primary School in Glasgow, and the school, you know, children come into the school about 8 o'clock in the morning. They have their breakfast from wonderfully welcoming, gregarious catering staff. You'll know the type that I mean. They then have 40 minutes of structured play with a third sector organisation. And the head teacher said to me, this is a partnership we've constructed because nobody plays with these children when they leave this school at night. So they have 40 minutes of structured play, and when they go into the classroom at 9 o'clock in the morning, they're in a better state, ready for their education. And the school is looking, I don't know if they've come to these decisions, but they're looking to put some of the other measures at the other end of the school day around homework support and around playtime and interaction and food after school, emerging out of the work that might be possible under the pupil equity funding. Now, that was some of the ideas they were milling about. Whether they've come to those conclusions or not, we'll find out. But what I thought that represented was a really bold set of approaches to meet the needs of young people and to address some of the deficiencies in the support that's available to those young people. And that's absolutely vital that we take that approach. So I think there is an opportunity to take that more comprehensive view, but it needs to be linked up with other public services and other organisations. On Jim's point about teacher recruitment, we are facing challenges around the country and in some particularly intense parts around the country. And we've increased again the intake into teacher training colleges this year by a further 370. And I'm in discussion with the teacher training colleges about how we can continue to increase that flow through more innovative ways, and obviously the General Teaching Council has got a significant role to play in that respect to assure us of the quality of the initial teacher education. But those steps have been taken to try to create the resource that we need to properly staff our schools. And obviously we're working closely with local authorities and with other interested parties on identifying the ways in which we can motivate more individuals to come into the teaching profession. And of course, the promotional campaigns that I launched in February are designed also to help to encourage people to make that career choice. And the General Teaching Council has assured me of their very close interest in ensuring that they can motivate registered teachers to re-enter the profession if they're not active in the profession, and also to make sure that accreditation for teachers coming into Scotland from other jurisdictions is handled efficiently and promptly to maximise the number of teachers that are available in the profession. And finally, Pauline's question about quick wins versus transformational change. I'm in this for the long haul, and I think we've got a really precious opportunity in this parliamentary term with the policy focus the First Minister has placed on the agenda of closing that attainment gap and improving performance in Scottish education to concentrate relentlessly on that endeavour, and that's exactly what I intend to do in my leadership of the education system. I think within that, we have to be evidence-driven. So when we see things that work, we should be prepared to change practice to make that happen. And where we see things not working, we should be prepared to say, look, we've got to change this and improve. And obviously, the availability of a greater volume of data to help to inform some of those judgments and to inform them in an open, participative way. You know, I should come back to the point that I made in my speech. The opening up of data to allow us to have the conversation in Scotland and Scottish education is about one thing. It is about making sure we maximise the outcomes of young people, for young people in Scotland. It's not about having a kind of finger-pointing discussion, which I know is taking place elsewhere. It's about improving performance and taking the steps openly to do that and to do it in a supportive fashion. And what's underpinning my views in the governance review is how do we take steps to make sure that we strengthen the supportive culture within Scottish education to improve performance. And my appeal to all interested parties in that process is how we can bring together all of our expertise to support the strengthening of Scottish education.
Thank you. There's a lady in the third row here, the gentleman here, and then the lady in the back.
Yeah, you're fine. Yeah, you're okay.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Davidson. I'm the director of the new Institute for Inspiring Children's Futures, which is a partnership of CELSIS, the Centre for Excellence for Looked After Children, and the Centre for Youth and Criminal Justice at the University of Strathclyde. I'd first like to say how much I welcome the whole system approach that you're speaking about, the focus on the whole learner journey and the whole range of systems that are involved with this work, and in terms of putting children at the center of all public services. So I'd like to ask you a question specifically related to your delivering equity ambition that we share, and all of us share in this room. Our interest at the Institute of Inspiring Children's Futures is children and young people who are facing adversity in particular. And those children will, of course, be growing up in families who are struggling and may indeed be looked after. I'm wanting to ask you about the point you made about interrupting generational patterns, and in particular, what role might you be asking adult services to be playing, for example, mental health services, addictions, and domestic violence services, who are working with the very families who, as you know, will be really engage children that can ensure that those particular children realize their potential. And I'm wanting to note finally here that I think we have an unprecedented opportunity, particularly given the opportunity of your leadership here, government, First Minister. I wonder if it's about that.
Okay. Hi, Tam Bailey, Children and Young People's Commissioner. I welcome the comments of children and young people being at the Heartland process. My observation on that is we've got a very long way to go within our education settings for that to be the case in terms of their views, opinions to be taken into account. So I look forward to further guidance and more assertive guidance about how that would be achieved. But my question really is about benchmarks. So I note that there will be benchmarks in terms of literacy and numeracy. Health and well-being is the third pillar of our curriculum for excellence, and that's commendable. But it hasn't been given the same care and attention, I would say, in terms of literacy and numeracy. So my question is there an intention to benchmark health and well-being as that third pillar of our curriculum for excellence?
Thank you. And then it's late in the back.
Hello, Eileen Pryor, Scottish Parent Teacher Council. Really welcome your comments about school leadership and the focus on strengthening that. And also very interested in your teaser around the governance review outcomes in the summer. I hope when you come to that, that you will reflect on the fact that the biggest difference that we can make to children's outcomes is through engaging their families in their learning. So while parental involvement in school is certainly significant and we would not underplay that, actually we must focus our attention on ensuring that schools engage fully with families in the learning and build that in to the governance review. Thank you.
Thanks. Jennifer, on your point, I think there's quite a lot of the ground that you raise, I think, comes out of Jackie Broughton's question as well. If a young person, I saw a wonderful play that was performed by pupils at James Gillespie's High School when I was there a few months ago. And it was just two pupils on the stage, and one was a teacher, one was a pupil, and they had the formal interaction between the two of them about why was the homework late, why are you late, why are blah, blah, blah. And then they both left the table with that conversation. And the teacher reflected on, I wonder what really is going on in his life. And of course, at the same time, the boy is out there saying, oh, not another night of drink and chaos and thumping. And so it was like a 5-minute performance by two young people in our education system, which captured utterly the point you're making, that there will be other things going on in life that we have to be, that we've got to take into account, we've got to find the ways of addressing and supporting. So again, I come back to my central message, putting the child at the centre of all of this and thinking, what else is going on? What else has got to be addressed in all of this is crucial to that journey. And in some circumstances, the level of support that will be required to help young people to achieve their educational potential will be just so much more difficult to achieve because of the other challenges that will be faced. But those challenges have to be faced to make sure we can support that young person properly. And it needs that integrated, cohesive approach focused on the individual child. And that is the approach that we are taking in public sector reform terms. So the messages that I'm setting out to you today are reflected very much in the thinking that the health sector has taken forward. When the government will be setting out the mental health strategy very shortly, and the mental health strategy brings together, it's been published by the health directorate, but we're as closely involved in its formulation and its design as the health ministers are, as are my colleagues in justice. So we're really weaving together many of these sentiments. On Tam's point, when the Chief Inspector of Education set out his revised guidance on curriculum for excellence in August, he essentially said to the system, there are 8 curricular areas, but 3 of them have preeminence: literacy, numeracy, and health and well-being. And the benchmarks will be, we put out the literacy and numeracy benchmarks first, but the benchmarks that we're setting out today will be for all curricular areas, including health and well-being. So the expectations will be set out very clearly as part of the work. And then finally, Eileen's point, the National Improvement Framework. I made the comment in my speech that one of the things that's really heartening me is the extent to which the National Improvement Framework and its clarity has been absorbed within the education system. And it's directing and driving practice in a whole variety of different ways. And I think and at the heart of that is about parental involvement in learning. And when we look at some of the measures that we've taken, such as the Book Bug initiative, for example, with the Scottish Book Trust, that's a very deliberate decision to try to take forward an approach which links parents directly into the learning of their children. And it's something that I think it's an initiative designed to try to reach into the household and to create that more supportive environment. And I think the more we can do that, the more the returns will be great for us in Scottish education.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid that's all the time we have for questions. There will be the opportunity, and I'll explain later, to send any further questions people have to Pam Simple, the National Improvement Framework Unit, and she'll get back to you. But in the meantime, if we could thank the Deputy First Minister for his speech and for his time. So yes, thank you very much everyone for your questions. As I said, if you didn't get the opportunity to ask a question you had, then Pam Semple's email address is on the invitations that you received. And if you want to send them to her at the National Improvement Framework Unit, she'll respond to them.